Ladies and gentlemen, it is my pleasure to introduce Garner Ted Armstrong of Ambassador College with The World Tomorrow. In this series of programs, we will tell you something of the problems of the world today, how they will affect you, and their solution in The World Tomorrow. Ladies and gentlemen, Garner Ted Armstrong.
The biggest issue of our day is government, right government. It's about time Americans, Canadians, and all of us took a look at the entire global arena of humankind and not just one nation as it strives to solve its own domestic, chauvinistic, racist, political, or other ills. Because after all, each nation is only a family. Each nation is a family grown great into a nation. Now, I know the United States of America is like a homogeneous mass of all kinds of different people because we are a multiracial society, as is true in Canada, and as is true in a lot of nations. It's not true in all, however. But what we need, and that most urgently, is some new world order. Hitler had the idea of a world order. He came on the scene as a virtual false messiah, little Adolf Schickelgruber, who wanted to lead the world into a German-style millennium. He must have somewhere along the line read a little bit about the Bible. He must have seen that the Bible predicts a 1,000-year rule on this earth of a super-government ruled by a divine being who is called Jesus Christ in the Bible. Oh, did I shock you there? Hitler actually saw that, but a lot of people in churches don't see that. Well, I can't apologize for them. I know that lots of religions don't believe that Jesus Christ of Nazareth said that he was coming back to rule the world. You know, you can't reconcile that and the idea of going to heaven. But Hitler saw that that's what Jesus said. And of course, you can see it too if you just read the Bible. All you've got to do is read what he said, what he promised his disciples about the fact of his return, and the only place where he promised the eventual position to a Christian, a person who does repent, a person who does overcome. Jot down a few numbers, and I'll get on with the subject. Revelation 2:26 and Revelation 3:21. And read those two scriptures. That's the promise, the outline of what the Christian hope is all about. To them that overcome will I grant to sit with me in my throne, even as I overcame and am set down with my Father in his throne. And to them that overcome, to him that overcomes, will I grant power over the nations. Well, at any rate, even Hitler saw what many church-going professing Christians don't, and that is that the Bible predicted a 1,000-year world order, a world government, that the Bible laid out a complete global reform, mankind putting an end to war, but not of, for, and by mankind, or as a result of human intervention or human cause. That's where Hitler made his mistake. He began to see himself in his own egotistical analysis of himself, which is commonplace to a lot of that type of individual, beset with an agonizing inferiority complex, bitten deep by his own self-guilt, his own personal and self-inadequacies, and that toadish desire for approval, and the swelling egotistical proportions of the man's demented mind, which may also have been influenced from some outer source, which led him into the belief that he was a virtual messiah who ought to rule the entirety of all of humankind, and that he could then solve all the problems. He saw in the Bible, no doubt, that the Bible talked about global agrarian reform, one world calendar, one world government and standard of laws, that it talked about the return of a race of people, as the Bible describes, to their own homeland. Now, a lot of people take exception with that. Well, it says in the Bible, believe it or not, salvation is of the Jews, but then Jesus explained that very quickly, because he said, if you be Christ, then are you Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. And he said, he has made all men of one blood to dwell on the earth, and in him we live and move and have our being, and he is not very far from any of us. So the Bible reveals that even though salvation was of the Jews, that Jesus was of the tribe of Judah, that he said he came to his own, and his own received him not. That salvation, and I'm not talking about being saved dead, I'm not talking about escaping. Christian escapism, which says, if you blow it here and now, then God will let you out the escape hatch, you go up to heaven and, oh, that's a nice wing you've got there. Let me look at that wing. And I guess all you've got to do when you stop to think about it is count those gold bricks in the streets of the holy city. Compare wings and shuffle endlessly through harp music. Now, there's a good tune. Oh, you know, when you think about that idea of Christian retirement, of lasting off up to heaven, I hear all these people so excited about going to heaven until it's time to go. And then they say, save me, Doc, you know. Somebody was telling me here just in the studio about the thing of Henry VIII, and I thought that that was hilarious. I can't quite repeat that the way he did, but it must have been a beautiful scene. Maybe you saw it. You know, carried to its ultimate conclusion, this weird idea that we are of and by ourselves immortal, that we have an immortal soul, which is weird. It isn't in the Bible, you can't prove it. But carried to its ultimate conclusion, this idea that you have an immortal soul inside of you can lead these priestly types, as it has in past history, to the point where if you can, with your last physical breath, you know, because they think you're a physical human being, you're just a body, you're a decadent old body, kind of worm-eaten, you know, filthy, dirty, needs to be washed. But inside of you, there's this pure soul that needs escape from this wretched body. And people say, I got to work hard to keep body and soul together. Well, we've talked about this business of the immortality of the soul and its tradition and its belief, and big religions with giant churches and tens of thousands of members believe it, but it's not in the Bible. Well, carried to its ultimate conclusion, that could kind of result in a brutality unparalleled in the annals of human suffering. And in fact, if you were to read a book like Fox's Book of Martyrs, you would discover that in the past that is precisely the way some of the priestly types looked upon it. That if with your last physical human breath, whether you were burning at the stake, or they were stretching you on the rack, or they were tearing your skin off of you while you were alive, you could say, I repent, or I do this, or I do that, whatever it is. You might have said abacadabra, which really means open cadaver, you know, open corpse. That's a horrible thing, but our kids don't know that. They think that witches, you know, they talk about a magic word as abracadabra. Well, they're talking in Latin. That has to do with opening a body, which is ghoulish to the extreme. But we don't know where we get these words. We just perpetuate paganism. And you're kind of looked upon as an iconoclast and a horrible tradition breaker and just a dirty, bad-mouthing guy when you inform people of some of our paganism. But if they could say whatever it was, hocus pocus, which is another pagan expression, or something like that, then magically their soul escapes. Now, forget the body. You can throw it out in the field and grow carrots with that. But that soul, that's something you want to really protect. Well, as I said at the conclusion last time, I don't want to be saved dead. I want to be saved alive. And as I said in an earlier program, I'd like to repeat it briefly. If you've got a guy that's going down for the third time in a peat bog and some priestly type shows up and says whatever he does, you know, bless you, my child, you said the right words, you're going to heaven. He might say, oh, no, I'm not, parson. I'm going straight to the bottom of this peat bog unless you give me that rope you've got there. And you could just hand it to him. And that would save the guy, you know. I mean, what we want to be saved from is we want to be saved when we're teenagers from pimples. And we want to be saved from, we want to be saved from not enough money. We want to be saved from fevers and night sweats and fears. We want to be saved from bad marriages. We want to be saved from fevers and colds. We want to be saved from agony and heartache. We want to be saved from accident. We want to be saved from our troubles, our ills, our worries, and our problems. But really, when you get right down to it, the innate desire in the heart of man is not to be saved from this good earth and go someplace else and shuffle endlessly through harp music and compare wings. There isn't any desire inside your heart to go to heaven. Your desire is to live a good life. That's what government is all about. We try to elect, I say we, the general public tries to elect a bright new young leader to give us all the things that everybody really thinks they want. Security, leisure time, better jobs, higher income, old aged and pension care and Medicare and kind of a cradle to the grave security, the good life, all of these wonderful things, more money, everything, less pollution, less crime, less racism, and everything we want, a wild free time in which we have got the freedom to do it unto others before they have a chance to do it unto us. And we want our government to give us that kind of a world. Well, you know, nearly 2,000 years ago, Jesus Christ of Nazareth came to this earth with a message about world government. What we need, and that most urgently, is a global world order. Now, in his perverted, demented approach to it, Adolf Hitler was trying to bring about world order with himself as dictator. And inasmuch as he had that view, and the idea of a super race, a perversion, again, of a Bible teaching, which has nothing to do with a super race, but has to do with the family of God, Adolf Hitler was therefore, I feel, my personal opinion, like a false messiah. He was certainly a false leader after whom the millions went and they followed him and ushered in upon this world a kind of a new dark age there for a few years. So It's about time we began to see that there is a real message about a coming global world government. And the one who brought that message was Jesus Christ of Nazareth.
Thousands starve daily because the 10% of Earth's surface which is productive is not enough to meet growing food demands. Yet if man could level most of the vast mountain ranges, raise up some of the deep arid desert valleys, renew the depleted jungle soils, and provide good gentle rain in due season, then he would have additional millions of acres of farmland. Man would have a solution to feeding the Earth's teeming population. Will such an answer be found? How will tomorrow's world be made free of starvation with the hunger bomb diffused? This free booklet titled The Wonderful World Tomorrow shows you the brilliant future ahead for man in a world where today's problems will be solved. It offers hope for the future and has a sure basis for that optimism. Be sure to write today for this free booklet, The Wonderful World Tomorrow, What It Will Be Like. Send your request to Ambassador College, Box 345, GPO Sydney, New South Wales. That's Ambassador College, Box 345, GPO Sydney, New South Wales.
If there were a president of the world today, what would be his state of the world message, his report to the entirety of humankind? I have an idea. This may not be exactly accurate because it goes back just a very few years, and some of these statistics will have changed by now, no doubt. But this came from a Look magazine interview with the Minister of Foreign Affairs, the Foreign Minister of Israel, Abba Iban, and he said this, and I want to quote his words. What would a president of the world responsible for human destiny have to report if he faced a universal parliament in the present year? So this goes back a few, and some of this may have changed. 60% of the Earth's land surface is arid or semi-arid, and this area is capable of supporting only 5% of the world's population. 95% of the Earth's population lives on 40% of the Earth's land surface. The inhabitants of the Earth now number about 3.6 billion, close to 4, and at the present rate of increase, will number 7 billion by the end of the 20th century. It's actually going to double by that time. More than half the world's present population suffers from varying degrees of malnutrition. The increase of food production is not keeping pace with population growth. Life expectancy, which reaches an average of 70 years in developed countries, drops to 30 years in parts of Asia and Africa. Some 500 million people are afflicted by waterborne diseases. He said a president of the world would have to report that some 700 million adults throughout the world are illiterate. Americans are a literate race and illiterate about the book that was a very firm belief in some of our founding fathers. We're a nation of biblical illiterates. We don't like to be told that, but it's the truth. We ought to read it and find out whether we are or not. We'd get a shock if we did. In economic and cultural opportunity, the disparities are already vast and growing wider. The most advanced countries are 3,000% more prosperous than the least advanced. A great migration from village to cities is going forward across the globe under conditions that increase the peril to health and social stability. Some of the world's natural resources are nearing depletion. I've told you in the past that they have estimated 50 years on natural gas. The Earth's atmosphere and water sources are being poisoned by wholesale pollution. There has been no diminution of the arms race and little progress in evolving agreed forms of international security. There is a wanton violation of rational priorities. A world that spends over $300 million a day, and I'm sure that is much higher now, on armaments cannot find $300 million a year to maintain an organization for the defense of peace. Fairly succinct, rather well put, whether you agree or disagree with the race, the nation, or the man who spoke those words, it's still a fairly accurate appraisal of the conditions, the global overview in which this world finds itself right now, humanity desperately in need of a world order. Did Jesus Christ of Nazareth come with a narrow-minded message of a pull yourself into your own inner sanctum of spiritual tranquilization and live happily ever after in the knowledge that you're going off up there into your Christian retirement, your Christian escapism, and let the rest of the world fry? Do you believe for one instant that Chinese people, who who died by the millions never having heard the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth are going to fry forever in a hellfire? Well, let me tell you that a lot of Christian thought assumes that that is true. The Bible doesn't. I mean Christian thought. I mean people who tell people about books written about men who wrote books about men who wrote books about the Bible. I don't know how it finally evolves into a, this is rather obscure to me, almost obscure as I think sometimes politics are to people, is the machinations of how doctrine finally gets gelled into shape and then what people say about doctrine and how doctrine can gradually change with the times. But I know that millions of people still believe in the idea of an ever-burning hell, and while other people say, well, it can't be that, it's got to be separation from God, then there comes along the type who wants to satisfy everybody. And so in one quick paragraph, he can say something about the kingdom of God, the government of God on earth, and going to heaven. You know, the minute you start talking religious terms, you tune people out anyhow. I can say it right quick. Justification, grace, works, faith, salvation. You see there? I lost you. The minute you start talking about theology and theological evangelical terminology, most people tune you out. I know one way I can always get an attentive crowd. I can walk up with a Bible in my hand to a graveside, and people are going to listen to me. They have to. It just would not be dignity. It wouldn't be apropos at all for somebody to come up and start arguing with me while his corpse is there. Somehow, in the presence of death, everybody gets real sober, and they're willing to listen to a preacher, a minister. Now, at conventions, they're not. See, I remember so well at the Democratic Convention, they asked this one poor man to get up there and lead them in prayer. And the cameras, as they do, you know, were going all over the place, and there were people up and down the aisles, and some were sleeping, and some were waving and hollering at each other, and others were on the phone. There were people being interviewed, and there was a lot of hubbub. And the gavel down, would you have it quiet, please? You know, the right reverend or pastor so-and-so wants to talk to God. And it just, there was a constant din. I couldn't help but reflect. I thought that, you know, if he'd have said, hold it, everybody, Ted Kennedy is on the phone from, he's calling long distance, and we're going to let you hear the conversation. Man, I'm telling you, the hush that would have fallen over that audience would have probably scared everybody awake and made half the babies begin to cry. No, they didn't have babies there, did they? It wasn't a family affair. Well, anyhow, it's just an observation of mine. You can call it a personal opinion. It's really what it is. I just personally opine that when somebody gets ready to talk to God, if we think it's one of the types, like the sky pilot type that the servicemen used to call him, sky pilot, he's going to get in communication with God. Well, people don't really think that's what he's doing. That's my point. It's just something that is a kind of a settled part of society. We would like to give him a moment's grace, a moment's peace, to say his bit and then get on with the business at hand. We don't think we're really talking to God. Well, maybe that's a part of our problem, is that we don't really think we can get in touch with God.
Why were you born? To become a farmer trying to feed the population bomb? To become an entertainer to give people a fleeting moment of laughter. To be a millionaire with big houses and fancy cars and ulcers. To live out your last days at the end of a plastic tube in a hospital. To be the last to die in a war you don't understand. Is that all there is to human existence? Just putting in your time on a troubled planet? No. There's a great purpose for your life, a reason you draw breath. And you need to know what it is. Read the free booklet, Why Were You Born? This knowledge gives reason to life, adds meaning to all you do. For a true added dimension to your life, be sure to read, Why Were You Born? Send your request to Ambassador College, Box 345, GPO Sydney, New South Wales. That's Ambassador College, Box 345, GPO Sydney, New South Wales.
It's a whole new ball game. It's a whole new world in which we live. It's so dramatically changed from World War II that it is scarcely recognizable to those who lived before, during, after that time. You know, even during the bombing of Japan, something happened to the American people and the whole world with it, I believe. For example, let me illustrate the point just by quickly reminding you of the differences between the British Air Force and the American Air Force As they waged war against Nazi Germany, and then finally the B-29 campaign from Saipan, Tinian, and Guam, and so on, against the Japanese cities at the close of World War II, finally America, and with America, other allies and other peoples, began to get the concept of global war against total populations for total stakes. Unconditional surrender was a policy pursued in spite of peace feelers by Japan, in spite of the most sincere and urgent desire of the Japanese government all the way to the Emperor Hirohito, who is still the Emperor, to have it stop short of that. During the early part of the bombing campaign against Nazi Germany, the British, because of terrible losses they felt would be incurred during the daytime, now this I'm taking time out to say briefly for the younger ones who may not know much about it, they adopted the policy of saturation bombing, nighttime bombing, of saturation bombing over vast areas of large cities, where the Americans had the idea of high-level precision daytime bombing. So by day, the American armada, sometimes 1,000 aircraft and more, would go across the German cities and would bomb them, one after another. Wuppertal, Mainz, Koblenz, Essen, Köln, Berlin, on they go, so many of them. And, of course, the firestorm of Hamburg and other cities that happened. It's unbelievable when you see what occurred in some of those cities, up to 80% destroyed. But, you know, by the time the war had advanced up into the mid-1945 era of the firebombing of Japan, then, at that time, the American High Command adopted the idea of saturation bombing, went in with incendiaries and began to just level. Now, somebody's going to write me some hate mail and saying, yes, but look what the Japanese did. That's not my point. I'm not waving the flag. I'm not talking now in terms of history, patriotism, who was right or who was wrong. I'm talking about the idea that something occurred to humankind in its experience of World War II, which changed the entire world, which changed our concept, our approach, and which changed us, perhaps, for all time. Then the concept was, in American minds, saturation bombing against total populations for total stakes is perfectly all right. Well, from that time to this, we have kind of teetered in this disequilibrium, in this gray area between a peace which seemingly eludes us and cannot be achieved and a war, a global war, which we know must not be fought. There is a scripture in the Bible that talks precisely about this groping in the dark. But first, I'd like to tell you what columnist Walter Lippmann said some years ago, the late Walter Lippmann. He said, the age we are living in is radically new in human experience. During the past 15 years or so, and this was written clear back 10 years ago, he said there has occurred a profound revolution in human affairs, and so he was talking about from World War II until the time in which he made this statement. It is enormously difficult to make peace. It is intolerably dangerous and useless to make war about the fundamental issues. That is where our contemporary frustration and confusion originate. We are confronted with an extraordinarily tantalizing and nerve-wracking dilemma. For as long a time as we see into the future, we shall be living between war and peace. He said there are no clear guidelines of action because there are no precedents for the situation in which we find ourselves. And as statesmen, listen to this, as statesmen grope their way from one improvisation and accommodation to another, there are masses of people who are frightened, irritated, impatient, frustrated, and in search of quick and easy solutions. Isaiah, the prophet, went him one better. Way back in the 59th chapter of the book of Isaiah in your Bible, you will read the following. Behold, the Eternal's hand is not shortened, that it can't save, neither his ear heavy that it cannot hear. When he says save, he means save alive, though, you know, and the preacher types might mean save dead, and I can't go along with that, and the Bible doesn't go along with it, because Jesus said in Matthew 24 and verse 22 that except those days were shortened, there should no flesh be saved. Moffat version has it, saved alive. He's talking about the salvation of humankind as a living species of life on the earth. And he's talking about inheriting and governing the earth and bringing the world one world order and right government for 1,000 years. And then from then on out into eternity is what the Bible talks about. Now, if you don't believe in the Bible, then fine, we're missing you entirely. You're saying, well, I don't believe in the Bible. If you don't, it's because you haven't proved it. But you're not saying to me or to yourself, I don't believe in the Bible because I've researched it, I've carefully checked it, I've proved it, I've read it back and forth, and then I still can't believe in it. What you're saying is you have an emotional, a glandular opinion, an opinion you inherited, an opinion somebody else gave you. Where did you get what you believe? How did it come into your mind? Well, through the five senses. And if you haven't yourself studied, checked, carefully proved, researched, then you just have to say to yourself, well, I don't, because it's just the way I feel. It's not because the way you think. It's the way you feel. But the Bible does say, and the Bible, if it is the criterion, if it is the basis for Christian belief, then the Bible only says one thing. It doesn't say 10 different things in the same place. The Bible asks, is Christ divided? I suppose the mainstream of Christian thought would have to say, oh yes, segmented into 400 little tiny cubes. We have him all labeled and put away into 400 different directions here. And there are 400 different methods to get to the same goal. And that goal, as I've said, is Christian retirement. It says here that the Eternal's hand is not shortened, that it cannot save, neither his ear heavy, that it cannot hear, but your iniquities, your lawlessness, has separated between you and your God, and your sins have hid his face from you, that he will not hear. And then he went on to say, why? Their feet run to evil, they make haste to shed innocent blood, their thoughts are thoughts of iniquity, wasting and destruction are in their paths. Verse 8, let's see if we can agree on this, the way of peace. Talking of governments and of world leaders, the way of peace they know not, and there is no judgment in their goings. He said in verse 10, therefore is judgment far from us, neither does justice overtake us. We wait for light. Oh, people go to the polls to try to vote it in, but behold, obscurity. For brightness, we walk in darkness. We grope for the wall. Like the blind, we grope as if we had no eyes. Oh yeah, Jeremiah said they cry peace, peace, and there is no peace. Isaiah said people grope like blind men, searching for peace, searching everywhere, but in the right place. Now world peace is going to come in spite of us, whether we want it or not. Compulsory joy is going to be ushered in upon this world, because let me tell you, I give you a different message than anybody else you've ever heard from before. Let me tell you, God Almighty is going to save you. God's going to save this world alive. Now, you can read it all if you write for this booklet, The Wonderful World Tomorrow, what it will be like. No price, free of charge. Now, maybe you've heard me announce that before, and maybe you've hesitated. You thought, well, there's got to be something in there somewhere. There's got to be a gimmick. There's got to be a hook in it. What is it? Maybe somebody told you, well, we want you to become a member of this or that. Maybe you're worried about somebody trying to kind of get you started on a reading program. It's going to lead somewhere you wish it wouldn't. Well, where, pray tell? What you do with what I'm telling you is entirely in your own private and personal affair. It isn't going to change what I do one way or the other. But these booklets are absolutely free of charge. There isn't any pitch. There isn't any hook in them. Nobody's going to give your name to someone else. You know, I'm saying that over the airwaves, and I'm held accountable for it. I'm held responsible for it. There is a federal government that has laws about advertising and whether it is false advertising or not. It would be absolutely illegal and against the law, and I could be arrested if I were to tell you there is no charge for these booklets, and then you found out we tried to charge you for them. So I'm telling you publicly, there is no charge and there is no request for money, either inside the booklet or to come along later. The good news of becoming government of God is best epitomized and set forth in this booklet, The Wonderful World Tomorrow, What It Will Be Like. That booklet is absolutely filled with dozens of scriptures that will show you where to find it in your own Bible. And all you need to do is to request it by sending your letter to Post Office Box 345, Sydney, New South Wales. Be sure to tell us the call letters of your station. We need that. That's all. There is no cost, but tell us the name of the radio station to which you've been listening, the call letters, and then send your letter to Box 345, Sydney, New South Wales. Until next time, this is Garner Ted Armstrong saying goodbye, friends.
You have been listening to The World Tomorrow. If you would like more information, write to Ambassador College, Box 345, GPO Sydney, New South Wales. That's Ambassador College, Box 345, GPO Sydney, New South Wales. Thank you.
Additional programs and literature available at hwalibrary.com.